Hi, myself Nilesh. So I work with ThoughtWorks as a DevOps person, and we internally adopted our virtualization with OpenVZ. So the agenda will be, so what are the different options available in virtualization? Why we pick the OpenVZ as a virtualization? There are limitations with OpenVZ, but with those limitations, how can we, you know, exploit the features available with OpenVZ? And questions. So basically, full virtualization has a bit overhead in terms of performance. So there is a layer for virtualization application which consumes pretty much of CPU cycles as well as memory, and there is a limitation for how many number of VMs you can spawn. Similarly, paravirtualization also has the same limitations, but it is more futuristic than the previous one. The third one is OS virtualization. It's not complete virtualization, but the kernel, operating system kernel itself is modified in such a way that you can create multiple OS but the same version. That means you can only implement Linux, but you can implement different distributions of Linux. So for example, Debian and RPM based like CentOS, Fedora, SUSE, Scientific Linux, etc. And the thing about OpenVZ is you can spawn pretty large number of VMs in comparison with the previous two. And the third feature is you can have dynamic resource allocation. Dynamic in the sense, as and when you want resource allocation, you just allocate resource, the allocation taken into effect immediately without rebooting, without any change. Just immediate resource allocation is there. You can directly get into the container and see what are the resources available to the container. So it's a hardware. We install some native OS, then install OpenVZ kernel, and then OpenVZ kernel allows us to install multiple VPS like virtual private servers, and which are nothing but the Linux kernels. Performance wise, there is a hit, like 1-3% performance it is there. So it's not like that, it's like better than others. And so processing in individual VPS are basically can exploit as much as your host can provide. So apart from this 1-3% overhead in processes, rest all can be utilized by individual VPS. Even one VPS, if it is needed, it can exploit entire host's ability to take resources. So there are limitations, like we cannot have multiple operating systems, only Linux is supported as of now, and that too with multiple distributions. So there are limited VPN capabilities, and yeah, so one host has multiple virtual private servers, so host is one point of failure where the capacity is limited. So the features are very minimal, overhead is needed to install OpenVZ kernel as such. The dynamic resource management in context with virtual private server, they have their, so it's a complete isolated system as such. So it has its own users, group, processes, network, firewall and routing, etc. So the individual VPS are efficient in utilizing resources, so they can so for example, in first case where emulation is option, then the number of virtual servers we can have is limited. So for example, with say 96 GB of memory Dell R817, we can have at most 40 to 50 VMs. With OpenVZ, you can spawn around 100 or 120 VMs, because of the fact that resource allocation does not actually guarantee that resources are utilized. So even if I allocate some 2 GB RAM of a particular container or particular host, doesn't necessarily mean that that host is actually using it. So the fair share which it is using, and the other one which is not used, actually used by other hosts, other VPS. So that's how you can actually scale up the number of VPS inside the OpenVZ. The other things are, you can create VPS in very short time. So on machine, like my laptop has a Core i5 processor with 8GB RAM, it almost takes seconds to create one VM. And the other things are like creation of VPS are from templates. So if we see OpenVJ container installation, there are predefined templates available. Previously it used to be like you can create your own template. Right now they are like decommissioning that part and they are giving you predefined options of templates. So templates like, for example, for Fedora, for Ubuntu, for Scientific Linux, etc. So there are predefined templates available. You can take that template, which basically has very minimal packages for installation, as well as the native kernel. So you can install it from the templates. So the beauty is like it's a basically individual machine, but the all file systems are, you know, extracted in Tarball. So it's similar to uncompressing the Tarball and have your OS ready. So that process basically untarring requires very minimum amount of time. And because of that, you can actually scale your infrastructure. You can have number of VMs in very, very short time. So to have a private cloud with OpenVJ, so it facilitates less number of physical servers, small VMs, and we can actually do the capacity planning. Like I said, the resources are shared. So for example, on 96GB RAM, you can actually allocate 2GB RAM on individual container and still have 100 plus VMs. So you need to do capacity planning at some point or another, because if all the containers are working at a high capacity, they'll break some things or another. So by using monitoring tools, like we use Node.js, Graphite and Graphius for trending, like, okay, these many resources are used, these many are free, so we can actually have this many number of more VMs. So we actually do the capacity planning, trending, and then have our individual VPS, so that whatever we commit to the as a quality of service should be retained when we do the service. So the dynamic resource management is one, and the so the parameters for individual VPS to configure are pretty large in terms of number. So these are UBC parameters. So there are the concept of UBC is user bin counters in context with OpenVJ. So there are 20 odd different parameters which previously are available. Even now they are available, but to reduce complexity, they enable vswap kernels. So for example, you just configure your swap and physical memory, that is RAM, and the rest all parameters are handled by kernel itself. So whatever processes are spawned, kernel decides, okay, this much memory I have, so this much I can give to individual process, and likewise. But you can actually configure like how much memory is needed for that particular process, how much guaranteed memory that process can take, how much actually you can allocate to that process. You can configure it manually. So that flexibility is there. So there are features like checkpointing. You can do live migration. You can have pre-built templates. So you know that, okay, this kind of server I need pretty frequently. So you can create that template for that particular server, have some predefined packages installed, and you just keep it shut down. So basically it is costing nothing but just this space. So whenever you want, you can actually start spawning VPS as and when it is required. So live migration in between your hosts is very easy. So it's like pausing a movie for say some seconds, like 1 or 2 seconds, and again it is live. Because there is small lag, like I said, in some seconds, 1 or 2 seconds is there, because initially it do rsync with the another host with SSH key, of course, and then it shutdowns the old VM and deletes it, and at the same time that VM is active on another host. Another customization you can do, so for example, there are some servers you frequently need your build servers. They are constantly, whenever developer checks in, suddenly build trigger, and you know, so there are multiple triggers happen in one day, probably 30-40 times your build server is busy writing data, logs, everything. So for that you can actually mount SSD for those particular server. So all activity disk IO happens on the SSD, which is fast, pretty fast. There are servers which need your storage, reliable storage, so you can mount SAN on those particular VMs. And then all this sharing of resources is easy in between the OpenVC containers or VPS, we say. That's pretty much all. So, do you have any questions? OpenVC has its own kernel, but you can install it on any host OS. So, for example, I have Fedora in my laptop. I can install OpenVC kernel and boot in OpenVC kernel and then start using that feature. I couldn't hear.
Because OpenVC is just a kernel, so you need something to download it.
Anything else? So you can add, there is nothing which restricts you basically. So it's just another hardware, another set of virtual servers in that hardware. You just need to configure the IP address and you can bound them. One VPS can have multiple IP addresses and vice versa. So one virtual private server will always have like 4 gigabytes of memory, one processor of say this much capacity. So it is not going to override that particular limit. The thing which I am talking about, you can have number of VMs with the same capacity. Unless they are using their optimal capacity, you can have multiple number of VMs. So that's
I'm very sorry.
It's okay. I can repeat my talk if you want.
That will be really awesome. I can find
more. I fast.
So have you faced any issues like I have faced with OpenVC running on Debian?
Yeah, because what I heard recently, probably this month or last month, that they are decommissioning the Debian support day by day and probably in future they may not have it. Yeah, it is kernel level. Right now it is supported. Even we are running VMs on the Debian kernel, but support is limited. So if you stuck something at, you probably may not get help. You are
what happens. So no matter how many limits you set up, SLCP, it's a daemon that connects to Elda. It's a caching daemon for Elda. That thing dies and it pulls the container with it and pulls the entire machine with it. So it's a really big problem.
So these parameters, so I may not know your exact problem, but individual containers have this parameter. So the parameters are accessed by this city IDs.
Yeah.
So here if you see fail count, so any parameter fails.
So that's what I'm trying
to say. No, so it's a diagnostic tool I'm saying. So any of the any of the fail count, these are zero means everything is working fine. Anything, so anything goes wrong, here you will see the number is. Not the same problem, but we have seen the fail count actually increase when there is something happens. So for example, what I have seen is, even though you don't have memory or you maybe more number of VMs you have allocated than actual capacity, some of the VMs starts, say for example, peak time, 10 to 5. So we have allocated the VMs to individual projects. Suddenly all of them started working and the host actually started running at a very high capacity. So that time the fail count start increasing. And the so parameters like KMM size, this pre-Vim pages, UMGAR pages, FIS pages and VMGAR pages, they start failing. Because these parameters means what you have allocated and what they are using is kind of, they are stuck. So you have allocated but they cannot use it. So they start failing one by one and eventually they'll take container down. But I haven't seen any time probably that they took the host down. But still that is a possibility, that's why I have listed, that is a possibility. Because ultimately these resources, they are using it from the host OS. So host karan, so these individual processes even though they... Yeah, so that's how we do capacity planning. So we actually monitor the host for its capacity. For example, RAM, CPU, IO, and there are number of other factors. So then we saw how many CPU cycles we left, how many RAM we left, and accordingly we add or migrate VM into another host. So that is how we maintain the cloud.
So which OS are you running?
CentOS.
And you're running a VZ on CentOS?
Yes.
VZs are also
CentOS VZs? No, VZs can be different. So we run majorly three flavors. Ubuntu, 2-3 flavors. CentOS, 2-3 flavors. And there are another, but I didn't recall.
Do you know why
Debian
support was deprecated?
No idea. I just heard the blog post from the one of the developers in OpenVZ.
One of the OpenVZ developers?
That they are not planning further. Means we can run it, but if we stuck at some problem, probably we may not get help. That's the point. Even in my rootconf talk, somebody has posted the same thing. That do mention this thing in your talk. So, which version you are running, OpenVZ? I think 2.6.42 stab version onwards, it's pretty stable. 42 onwards, it's pretty stable. Previously, it was not vSwap. Yeah, so previously it was not vSwap enabled. So, those were the time when we actually struggle a lot to stabilize.
42
onwards. 42 or 44 onwards.
That is
a VSWAP enabled. Means you don't have to care about individual resources. The kernel itself will take care of it. We usually templates and template caches for routine use or for use which, you know, we know that okay, these servers are going to be replicated multiple times. So just make a template and put it in some template cache, and you can use it anywhere you want. If you over capacity. Probably it is a KMM size issue. It's a KMM
size.
Probably, yeah.
No,
so,
KMM size is very big.
KMM is just monitor host KMM, kernel memory size, how much it is taking.
Never the kernel memory, you don't need that much. Why do you need that much?
No, the allocation to individual processes. How much it is allocating and how much.
I have 128 GB.
MB is enough, more 100 MB.
If program pages is getting breached, then we can understand the problem. But the problem manifests itself in an application level. So, a daemon running at application level crashes, takes the entire container with it, and the container takes the machine down. That's not true at all.
I haven't seen container taking machine down,
so,
but yeah,
I mean,
sometimes it happens. VPS.
The load on the box is 700. Do you see how we can talk? It's 400.
No, mostly it's a cut off. So you can always check if you deploy an individual application inside VPS, what is the minimum requirement for that application. So if it is not fair, it probably will going to give you like premium pages and user pages will come. Because it actually starts consuming more memory than actually container can upload. Then you can take container down with it. You want to iterate me?
So, how big is your installation of
OpenBSD?
How big is your installation?
It takes almost 2 or 3 minutes.
No, how big is your installation? How many containers do you have?
We have in one host around 100-120. Like that we have... Power of host is 96 GB RAM and 32 cores of 2. Because we actually monitor, we take Najos alert very seriously. Even if it is warning stage, somebody has to look. Because it's a quality of service. We are not using the VMs for our own. There are somebody who is using it. And we are actually think we are liable to give that much uptime.
So
even if there is one fail count, which person, admin person goes and look what is the problem, then probably things will not escalate to, you know, VPS level and VPS to host level. That much time you do not have, because it, one container down is not an issue, but if it takes 120 container down with it, it's a very serious issue. Then there is not only one. Which one?
That's the issue I face.
Yeah.
It does happen a lot.
Huh? Feedback is put alerts. It is always good to have monitoring on every VPS. That will be good. So we have two layer of monitoring. One is on the host itself, host hardware, and another is on individual VPS. Yeah. And we monitor them closely. So, you know, every like weekend, then we monitor, okay, this week, what has happened? Why these spikes are there? So that level, that granulation we need to do. Then only you can have excess capacity. So mostly servers, web servers, database applications, and CI tools, CI integrations, repositories.
Not all programs are defined generally. Thank you.